everyone. It's lovely to have you all. Those of you here in person, and those of you out there in the world joining us virtually in this teleconference. So just to give you an idea of what's going to occur tonight, most of you know, of course, that the information that I present, it comes through an entity that calls itself Michael, and now particularly an evolved aspect of Michael that refers to itself as the Consortium, or Michael's Consortium, which is Michael reunited with its cadre mates on the mental plane. However, since many of you are familiar with the concept of overleaves and soul ages, which is the foundation information that Michael produced through Sarah Chambers about 40 years ago, and then presented originally by Chelsea Quinn Yarborough, know that the value and the usefulness of that terminology and that structure has never waned. So on evenings like this, a select number of Michael's channels here on in the world, myself being one of them, receive essentially a character profile for approximately 12 months of the year that will be affecting human beings as sort of an overarching milieu of feeling, of tendencies, and influences. And that terminology, of course, is we refer to as the overleaves. And so this evening is the overleaves for 2017. Now, how tonight will be structured essentially is that I will go through all the components, most of which many of you will recognize, some of which you may find are a little new and different because they've been introduced to me through the consortium. Also, just in recognition, each of us channels have varying relationships with fragments of the Michael entity, and therefore often have different takes on what a particular year's influences will be. So I invite you to hear this particular arrangement of influences, and if you find some of the other agents of this teaching out there, by all means, please investigate this set that they present and see what kind of information that you can derive from it. All of it has the ultimate goal of expanding awareness and improving one's vocabulary to understand the building blocks of the physical plane. If that is accomplished, if that is an expansionary piece that gives you a wider viewpoint and a more articulate viewpoint of how this place is built, the interactions that those parts then happen or create or cause, and then how they affect you as having your own set of overleaves, then our job, our work to educate you, to give you this viewpoint that is wider, has been accomplished. So with that being said, I want to take a moment just to recenter, and then we will begin. So good evening. Approximately 2 months ago, many of you experienced a shock on November 8th, 2016. We metaphorically quipped that it was the day the earth stood chill. And we use that phrasing not because of that a single man was elected into the arguably most powerful political office in the world, let alone this land, but rather an entire mindset had been reestablished here on the physical plane. That mindset that Donald Trump and the entire milieu and mindset that follows him into creating this administration and now the formation of the government represents a terminology that we use commonly called a soul age, representative of a soul age, but a vast split. In the world for the last 40 years, we've been talking about the upcoming advancement of moving into the mature soul era. And for those of you who have never heard this before, just a quick recap. There are five stages of soul evolution: infant, baby, young, mature, and old. And your point in history now is literally the most significant evolutionary stage that this race, but indeed this planet, has ever faced, for reasons that we'll get into shortly. So right now, you've been at the crux between the last stages of the late young soul era, which is characterized by things like ambition and domination and technological advancement and worship of the mind and materiality like property and money and so forth. And at the crux of moving into a mature soul cycle, which begins to reevaluate all those things and see more of the necessity for realistic sustainability, movements toward formulating cooperative rather than competitive structures for institutions and ways approaching life. Now, given the fact that humanity is now 7.3 billion people, and that virtually every part of the arable land on this globe has been used for agriculture or people to live in, or been mined or in some way harvested, with the exception of a tiny, tiny percentage that is in nature preserves and natural parks and so forth, never has the earth been put such under heel by any one particular species. So much so that the depletion of the resources is literally at a point of critical mass as far as this departure as far as sustainability for the human race to thrive in the long run. And beyond that, possibly even struggle to survive here. So this election represented a huge step backward, and or if you will, a huge split between what we would call the mature and old soul mentality that has not been dominant on the planet, but that has been growing in population numbers, and the dominant paradigms as defined by the historic, religious, very hierarchical, strict, somewhat emotionally occluded baby soul mentality, mixed with this young soul mentality that's built on top of it, instead of having rules like baby souls, eschewing them, and then expanding, and sensory pursuits of pleasures and personal gain and so forth. Well, instead of making a leap, what has happened over the last 30 years has been a progressive, what we call a backlash. And this backlash has manifested itself. And from this point forward, in the experience of most of you who here listening and who are present would come under either the end of the hidden generation, which is that grouping between the baby boomers and the greatest generation. But most of you are baby boomers, and then some of you are the otherwise reticent and Gen Xers, as you will. And a few of you are millennials, so welcome here. But predominantly the old souls that found this teaching and it appealed to are those that we call the baby boom generation. They're the ones who have essentially ushered you to this point in history. Well, we give you that just simply to say is, all of you baby boomers, you're going to die before you ever see some of the worst of the ramifications that you have helped us to take over the top and the ripple effects of that will be going on. With that said, then this year, 2017, represents an entirely beginning of a new cycle, a new era, if you will, of if you will, division world, more so than we've actually seen since about 75 years ago, back into the 1930s. This division, however, is different in that this era is much more crowded with human beings. But also, there is something that is profoundly different than has ever happened before in human history, and that is, this is the era of complete technological surveillance. And why that's significant is because once upon a time, people's thoughts and movements and actions were largely free or at least unobserved until a person made an appearance somewhere, someplace, for some reason. Now, because of the nature of whether it's the tracking of your telephone bills or what you watch on television through your cable channels, how your bank accounts are registered in databases, to the cameras that snap pictures on street corners and in closed circuit televisions, your whereabouts and your actions, but also your behavioral and psychological trends are being aggregated. So the degree to which you can experience freedom from this surveillance, this observation, is more invasive than it's ever been. And with that, we will then jump to this new era and begin the Overleaves discussion with what is always the pinnacle or the centralizing force aspect of any given year. And we, in our terminology, we call that the role energy. So the role energy of 2017 is the priest role. The priest role has the positive pole energies of compassion, calm, guidance. In the negative pole, it has the qualities of righteousness, smugness, zeal, and superiority. Now, in the way that we cast overleaves, we also talk about a secondary role's influence of the first. So in this particular occasion, we're going to be talking about a priestly energy that has what we would term a sagely cast. So again, we will elaborate on these as we go, but for the sage, the positive pole is dissemination, potentially wisdom, truth, and lightheartedness, humor. In the negative pole, it can be oration, hyperbole, obtuseness, and verbal deception. The goal for this year, which represents think of it as the large-scale stream that is affecting your overall consciousness of what you will be looking at as a race, but then individuals in that race as well, to determine for yourselves. Well, of all the seven goals, the one that we're announcing today represents probably one of the most potent and challenging of them, and that is the goal of submission, which is the warrior's goal. In the positive pole, submission is devotion, allegiance, and loyalty. In the negative pole, it is subservience, defeat, numbness. Now, as you can hear, those words on both sides will call upon you at a very deep level, and because they really represent affecting your power as an individual and how you use it. But submission is not a goal that is about using your power for your own sake. And that is what makes it often so incredibly challenging because it represents a surrender to what would be for you personally a person, purpose, principle, cause, or ideal that you hold in enough esteem that you would step your own importance and your own needs aside to make them primary. And of course, in a culture as me-oriented, as it were, self-indulgent, and highly focused on one's own identity, to set aside all of those qualities can represent quite a challenge, and we'll again be discussing that more. Now, the overleaf characteristic that then affects your mindset, if you will, the mental frame of reference that you choose to evaluate and even help you to populate or seek to understand the goal for yourself, is in this case the attitude of realist. Now, realism in the positive pole represents the words objectivity, clarity, and self-directedness. In the negative poles, it is speculation, subjectivity, and compilation. The attitude here represents one where if you can come into this with your eyes open, wide, you can gather all the pieces and organize them to see which ones truly are the most significant, but also which ones are materially important as opposed to abstractions, which is what we mean by in the negative pole about subjectivity. So, moving on then, so we have the priest energy with this high need to bring about some form of awareness on healing and spiritual point of view to the common good, to the higher good more specifically, looking to figure out how to do this very deeply personal submission energy and using the attitude of realist as the means to separate it all out. In this teaching, we also talk about that there are natural kind of barriers or that there are natural hindrances that can get in the way and influence, or should we say, detrimentally distract a person from being able to look at their goal clearly or to use their attitude in a complete way. Then we call those chief features or chief negative features or chief obstacles. Another term we use is a primary ego defense system. In this teaching, we talk about the fact that it is quite common that people can have two of them if you were dealing with an individual. And one of them, the primary one, as we would term it, it affects the attitude. And in this particular case, we're talking about the chief feature of greed affecting the realist attitude. Now, in a couple of words, greed, in its positive pole, has a sense of, when we use the term here, it means at least it's forward-directed and has a positive intent, but it's a positive intent to overcome what it feels a native deficit. So greed in itself is all about a perception of scarcity, shortage, lack, and therefore an exaggerated sense of I might not have, so it's an overcompensation. In the positive pole, it can fuel desire. It can help with aspiration. It can help for, particularly for older souls, with a sense of ambition to try and move them out of the natural kind of tendency that more old souls go on than not instinctively, which is sort of a accept and go with the flow sort of orientation. Ambition, of course, is not go with the flow. It is direct the flow. Well, the severe part of greed then affecting the realist is in the negative pole. And that is gluttony, lack, insatiability, and shortage. Now, we'll talk about these overleaves in combination tonight, both how they affect the individual, but also how they might appear on the worldly stage. So as you listen on and these things are become more registered in your mind, we'll be mixing them as combinations to try and help you to understand what you might be dealing with more interpersonally, between yourself and someone else, but also intrapersonally, within your own psyche, within your own beingness. Now, the second chief feature, then, of this year affects the goal of submission, and this will probably represent a very, very compelling, if not difficult one for many people. And that is, it's the goal of chief feature of stubbornness affecting the goal of submission. So you can probably hear from the words themselves, submission implies this idea of surrendering to something, to potentially giving up a part of yourself. And stubbornness is the resistance to do that. It does not want to change because its native predisposition is the sense that it doesn't have knowledge of the future, that of what would happen next, of whether or not it has the capacities to make change without in some way, encountering some form of pain or disaster. And since stubbornness is the assimilative chief feature, it has the unfortunate quality that many of you will find that it can do something that we call slide to all the other six qualities or ego defenses. And it will slide to particularly the ones that you yourselves have to work with. But that overarching energy of stubbornness will be subtle, and it can even look slippery. Because in the positive pole of willfulness, of determination, of steadfastness, even tenacity, those qualities can be utilized to help pull you through change, that's true. But generally it's done, as the old comedians would say, screaming and kicking. And then you have probably the purest form of understanding of stubbornness in the negative pole, which is obstinacy, entrenchment, and defiance. And there, of course, you have the tendency of a person to just dig his heels or her heels, as it were, in and fight to not accede anything to anyone. And of course, this can ultimately be overwhelmingly problematic both for an individual, but as you can well imagine, and look around your American society right now, you can see how it also makes for creating polarization stuckness in groups of people. So, affecting submission then is stubbornness, affecting realism is greed. As we move on to the characteristics of this year then, we go through and we talk about the method, or the mode as we term it, of the strategic ways of behaving, the propulsion, and the formulation or stance that you might take on to best deal with this year. And the mode of 2017 is the mode of power. Now, power in the positive pole is authority. It is also, again, a form of determination. It has with it an overarching sense of potential toughness and knowledge. But in the negative pole, it is obstinacy. It is patronizing. And by patronizing, we mean it in both sense, that it is that it looks upon others in a, as they as diminutive, and that patronization as something as of they being superior. But also we mean it in terms of patriarchy. Power mode being the tendency to want to drift in to some of the negative or most or more hostile characteristics of masculine energy. So, power mode then, what it means on a philosophical level is it is the way that you will achieve the goal. So, power on submission will be a very interesting combination, but it will also be a, to carry out the word into a similar one, an empowering characteristic if you are able to understand what authority really means. And authority for yourself as an individual means to author your own life. It means to live authentically. Notice that those same roots all refer to the same thing. It does not mean that you suddenly have to become a bodybuilder or an expert in anything. Those are some of the ways that it may sometimes appear. Instead, what it means is you really dig down and you find the script that you've been living from. Because it is the sage's mode, and greed being the sage's chief feature, both of those will team up in the sage cast year to really want you to probe down in yourself and say, in this milieu of just craziness where truth has taken a battering and indeed seems to be non-existent anymore and even somehow indistinguishable of being known, that outer world assessment, while very true at the current time, doesn't mean that it needs to affect your inner world. Indeed, it may influence and make it more muddy, because in trying to look for solid representations or examples in your outside world, and they're very, very fluid and very, very based on that speculative negative pole of realism. Nonetheless, your job to get to some your positive pole submission is to begin to really understand what your truth is, what is the basics of your principles that then lead to this quality of locking in or at least moving you down the road on what you want to become devoted to on the goal. Next, after the mode, there is a way that the body types have an influence on the year, but that is more metaphorical. So the body type that is predominant this year is the Saturnian body type. The Saturnian archetypal energy assumes a posture in the positive pole of like leadership, stature, dependability, and demonstrating an air of stability. In the negative pole, however, the energy that the Saturnian body type presents is one where its boniness, if you will, its structure is beginning to brittle or break down. The hunchback or the osteoporosis looking kind of person that we might call gaunt, who's been sapped of vigor, who's no longer formidable, that person, excuse me, has a body that looks emasculated or emaciated, and even their strength looks like it's atrophied. And as you can already guess, when we talk about it being a posture, we're talking about it being, if you will, adjectives that describe the structure of not only how you should take a stance, the old terminology of, you know, stand up straight, shoulders back, chest out, is literally the terminology of the Saturn body type in the positive pole. And that is a formidable force. It presents that power mode energy in a way that is projective and a way that says, I am standing my ground and I will not be bowled over. But on the other side of the equation, structures that are no longer stable, that are no longer integral, that are no longer built upon living in meaningful principles or nurtured by, you know, continuous utilizing those parts of yourself or supportive institutions, then they become emaciated, they become weakened, they begin to fail in their effectiveness. And in a year like this, we can tell you that you will see a number of institutions, not just across the American governmental structure, but even those informal ones, like family and networks of individual groups of people, will begin to really buckle and lose their vitality because of this strength of that alienation energy that we spoke of a little bit earlier, tearing people into individual parts. Which brings us now to this aspect of when we talk about individualism, we want to talk about the scope or the range or the way that you would best consider tackling this year or coming to terms with it. And what that coming to terms with it would be is we call it of our two terms, ordinal versus exalted or cardinal. This is what a year that we would refer to as ordinal. And even with all these exalted overleaves, these ones that have this broader array of influences. Nonetheless, it is for you to take these and to bring them inward to yourself. So, I mean, as we're defining it here tonight, we want you to understand that ordinal means personal in this particular way. It means intimate. It means informal. And as you can see, the degree to which formal language is being abandoned all over the place, and this more raw expression of self, whether it's terse or even emotionally authentic, in both cases is very prevalent. And that's at least a function in part of ordinality. Now, just by contrast, so you understand what exalted would mean in this regard, is that much of the energies of these overleaves, while they would and certainly do and will have impact on worldly institutions or people who are very highly in the public eye or influence or in this case destructiveness on the formal structures of things and the ways that people interact with each other, protocols for nation states interacting. Those would be exalted qualities. And yes, they'll be influenced or they'll be affected. They'll be shaken up. But the real focus of this year is one of everybody pulling back inside, taking a deep breath, and actually letting out, exhaling, as they say, from all the tension that has been just built up. And not to mention acknowledging some of the exhaustion that most people feel, especially, again, you older souls, mature and older souls, who have just experienced 2016 as a either terrific setback or a great defeat to your principles, ideals, or sense of progress. For you, this is about internalizing all this material and reconstructing a self on a personal basis first, before you then turn and take that energy and direct it outside, let alone throw yourself into some bigger, grander thing. Now, we'll get back to, you know, what to do with yourself in just a bit as we continue to move through these descriptions. So this ordinal priest year, then, is about learning to find hope, compassion, a sense of where guidance comes from inside of yourself, and share that personally. It's sharing that in a way that is helping to minimize its negative pole energy, which is that sense of righteousness, that superiority, that need to overcome any sense of inferiority by identifying it outside of yourself and overrunning it. Instead, this is an inward job. So, continuing on. How, or in what flavor, what degree of propulsion, and then how fast might some of these changes and might some of these alterations occur? Well, when describing those characteristics of a year, we start off with the pacing or the rate of speed that you might perceive changes happening or not happening. And we call that the quality of frequency. Now, in a person, we want to, for those of you who understand and use the term frequency and vibration interchangeably, please understand we mean them differently here. Vibration, in its purest sense, how we use it, talks about the being filled with light and being of lightness, the ability to be in a meta state because you are not caught up in the Maya and the density of the physical plane's negative pole of the realist attitude, where you are above, or at least capable of standing aside and being present with your own process, but not necessarily being thoroughly enmeshed by it. That's what we mean by high vibration, and then, of course, low vibration is somebody that is totally captured by their opinions, their emotions, is relatively unconscious to their own drives, their overleaves, their hidden agendas, and also feels a sense of such incredible deprivation in one part or more of their lives that they are constantly in defense. That is what a dense vibration person is. Now, by contrast, frequency. We want to make clear we are talking about frequency in the sense that a sound engineer would refer to wavelength. And in that regard, we're talking about the speed at which that wave travels. Now, this year, by the way, the scale that we utilize for that frequency is measured from a simple just kind of 1 to 100, where the 1 would be the proverbial tortoise at the starting gate, almost completely still, without motion, maybe just breathing. And then at the other end of the scale, metaphorically, would be the rabbit or the hare, completely jittering, ready to just spring and then sprint with in all-out exertion all the time. Humans have frequencies. You know them by the way you when you talk to somebody or see how quickly they bounce from one thing to the next. Or how slowly they move, how deeply they contemplate, how much time it requires for them to process something. Neither are better. In fact, both are necessary on the physical plane at various times. The greatest skill that a person can develop is to know when to slow the hell down and when circumstances are such that you need to be nimble and quick to respond. But to have that facility to do either is the key. Well, a year, like a person, then has a tendency to hover around a specific set point, a kind of an average pace. And on that scale of 1 to 100, this year is actually somewhat moderate because it's at a 55. Now, granted, that's a little bit more than, say, a very brisk brisk walk. We won't even use the term very, if you were to use the metaphor of motion that way. But compared to last year's 87 pace, which most of you could tell because suddenly it's 2017 and 2016 was like just a breath away. This year, you will experience things where you will have more time to discern and notice things around you as they're going on. Actions will not be micro-reactive and quick, and where all of a sudden one thing happens and you're on to the next. Nor will you see that in the public space. Instead, what you'll see is when you look around in the world, but also particularly in yourself, you will have more time to evaluate. And in that evaluation period, it will seem to you at times that life around you, or at least your ability to make a decision in reaction to life, will not be necessarily as quick as you like it to be. Which brings on another point then about the centering of this year, which is very powerful. And when we talk about the centering, we are talking about the energy side of our triad that describes the universe. The triad being truth, love, and energy propellants that construct the metaphysical universe, which is the foundation of all creation. And each year, we talk about one of those three is the preeminent or predominant quality. And this year, it is the energy side as represented by the higher moving center. Or in what some of the books have termed also the higher kinesthetic center or the sexual center. Now, those three terms we use interchangeably, and those of you who know this teaching also know that there have been some terminological changes, and we just want to acknowledge that the higher moving center then is an octave above, represents this energy pillar within the triad, but has its counterpart, its more what we would refer to ordinal counterpart of the moving center, which has also been called the physical center, and originally in this teaching referred to as the sexual center. But we've made that distinction, and we just refer to the ordinal as the moving center or the physical center. Physical meaning, of course, sensorial aspects of your body. So just definitionally by contrast. When we talk about the energy of the higher moving center, we're talking about the experience of harmony, of being in a form of symmetry with your life and with, particularly with nature, the physical qualities of your humanness, but also of the collective life force of all the species of the planet. And in the positive pole, then, other terms that go along with that, as we said, are beauty, are symmetry, a sense of awe. Being in the groove, if you will. What Abraham Maslow called the peak experience. Now, what we think we will see more of this this particular year, is in the negative poles, you have what we call lust, hunger, eroticism, perversion. Those are qualities that when your sense of energy is out of whack, or it's distorted, or it feels impacted by damaged energy, or oppressive forces in the greater milieu of either your own personal energy field, what you call your aura and your chakras, or out there in the world, which you can think of environments, whether they be those that are rural or those in cities or those, you know, that are created by the group thinks of nations, let alone humanity as a whole. So in a very real sense, when we spoke earlier about this departure between the, or this division, rather, between the mature and old soul mentality, which is felt right now in this contraction of feeling some exhaustion and being beat up, there is this distortion of the higher moving standard it experiences of exhaustion and a tendency, along with greed, then, to want to fill the gap with things that are sensorial, that are creature comforts, that can be potentially addictive because they are seeking to soothe these damaged qualities. Now, in these younger soul, this younger soul division of the young baby, and indeed even the remaining infant souls that approximately are 8% of the population in this world, the manifestation of the higher moving center will be various degrees of suppression of their sense of being one with the earth, and then on other in other degrees, extensive self-indulgences. And of course, that will be something we'll talk about when we refer to this idea that's come to be known as the 1% and their concentration of energy, pulling it out of society as a general thing. When we talked about the mode, we talked about maybe the way you go about harnessing your power, and of course we said power mode, but the mode will be constrained, or at least shall we say channeled, in either a very narrow kind of tight beam, which we call masculine energy or yin energy or convergent formulation, or it will be diffused, spread out, wide streamed, that we call feminine or yin or divergent energy. Now, every year, just like every human being, has a masculine energy, masculine and feminine energy balance. In other words, both are present at the same time. And we use the term masculine energy and feminine energy as opposed to male and female because you need to understand masculine energy is not specifically about males, the sex, or men or manhood, the sense of maturity, and nor is female femininity about the female gender or womanhood in a sense of maturity. Masculine energy represents, in the positive pole, this narrowing, focusing, sharpening, honing, and linear kind of quality. It is a concentration of energy into a narrower band. It is the creation, say, of a laser. By contrast, and that's in the positive pole, in the negative pole, what you have is a laser that is so without controls, or so without, should we say, the flexibility to alter it, that it's hyper-controlling, and that we would define the negative pole of masculinity then as rigidity, as intensity, and hostility. So it's 45% of this year, which means that those qualities, both positive and negative, are going to be overshadowed by the feminine, broader-based kinds of qualities that makes things a little bit more scattered, nonlinear, and therefore not sequential in things happening. The positive pole of femininity is flexibility. Its ability to move and sway and also not hardly defined. It is a softer quality. But it does not mean that it is also in any way a weaker quality. What it is because it is more distributed, we would compare it, the difference between masculine and feminine, as masculine being rock and feminine being water. Now, if any of you have ever experienced a belly flop, you know that water is potentially just as hard and affective as any rock is. And if someone would wake Artis up, that would be much appreciated.
I'm not asleep.
Oh, you're not. We heard somebody snoring.
Oh, so. That could have been Tamara.
Oh, very good. All right, then. Wake her up instead. So this balance, then, toward feminine energy is 55%. What that means in terms of the way that you make decisions or that you see the experiences of things happening around you is that your own idea to maybe hone in on a goal, or, and that is to say, when we mean a goal, we mean in the more traditional sense of say, a measured task, is not as linear or as direct from A to B as you might like or even think. There's liable to be more interruptions. There's liable to be times in which things pause and there's cessations, in which case the prescription for that would be is that is when you are experiencing more of a feminine energy, in which case notice where flows take you. They might momentarily take you to say, you know, stop and just to get on to something else. And then you'll see opportunities arise again to begin something new. And if you can adapt yourself, especially in combination with the higher moving energy, to that sort of Tai Chi-like or Qigong-like sensing of energy and moving with it accordingly, where you exert sometimes and then you pause sometimes, that you're going with the motion of tides rather than swimming against them. If you can learn that, you will find that you will be able to maximize not just your effectiveness in terms of achieving things that you actually want to have happen, but you will also find another aspect of the higher moving center, which we call serendipity, which also happens to be a part of the quality we call the nexus. Because with serendipity, it means that you are able to receive directions from the Tao, or specifically your Tao's unique emissary, which we call your essence, much more directly and fall into that without having to do exertion. And given the fact that many of you will be struggling with stubbornness and also the idea of giving up things or at least honing in on things under the goal of submission, being able to do that as fluidly as you possibly can will go a great way forward to making this year less exhaustive and less of a battle on yourself. So that's the masculine and feminine energy. So to sum up all these, the priest role for the year, which makes this an inspirational quality. The inspirational axis dominating means set an intention. If there's anything, don't make New Year's resolutions. Just set an intention. And since the priest energy is the exalted inspirational role, make it one of your own spiritual aspirations. And since it's being cast in the form of devotion to a goal and to feel empowered with that, make it so it's very personal. Remember that the priest wants healing in the highest possible way. And so having yourself begin to really come about and seeing where you have been either off your intentions or none at all, you will escape the very broad morass that is the negative pole of the inspiration axis, which is despair. Because despair is to live life without intention. It is to experience no hope. It is to have a loss of faith in yourself and to experience a maximum isolation and therefore alienation from other people. Instead of feeling a part of something, you feel apart from others. And those qualities then are the two, if you will, contrasting ways to understand how you might work your devotion this particular year. And then the simplest one is to use that sage cast energy to continue, even in the smallest ways, to make connection, to reach out, to communicate. And to communicate, the priest in the negative pole will want to tell, preach, prognosticate, dominate, evangelize. Instead, use the other skill that the healer priest, but also the wise sage use, and that is listen. Listen. And ask constructive, but invitational questions, ones that pull people out. These overleaves do not lend themselves very well to emotional safety. People are much more focused, as you know, right now in this world, about material security, whether it be from their person or their access to few resources, but also, more subtly, even their sense of identity. And this is particularly true for males the world over. That's why many males are so either falling in and crumbling or becoming so angry and bitter, because they're being that material security, or should we say the overwhelming insecurity, and that despair is driving them by virtue of the way that the world's this split has really exemplified. So asking those questions about those things, how do you feel, what is it for you, instead of engaging in verbal combat about, well, this is why you're wrong and this is why I'm right. That's the priest and the sage engaged in the worst kind of reinforcing polarization. But finding out what's important to people about the goal, asking them what's real to them, these will be tactics, these will be ways that you will be able to find ways of restarting to build these bridges. A period or a decade where all these changes in the way human beings will relate to this higher sense of fragmentation and polarization and factionalism will be played out. Love the people that are closest to you. Find ways to share love and hope, even in the simplest of extensions to folks. You don't have to befriend anybody. But if you are able to give, as they say in the old biblical terminology, the milk of human kindness in just even small doses to persons that you encounter, that will go a long way to slowing this diminution that we've been talking about. Because, folks, the, if you will, the motto of this year, a painful one, a scary one for many, is this shit is about to get real. And most of what you've, many of you old souls in this room, have gone along with the beliefs and the hopes and the aspirations of the new age and the human potential movement, and you've seen a lot of them collapse under the weight of this increased anger and this increased fear. So it's not about resurrecting anything. It's just finding the true substantive pearls, the principles, the values that are really universal to all people, even if they're expressed in oppositional opinions, and begin to start building on those. So, one last piece that we want to offer you as a, so to speak, as a little bit of tickling your imaginations. And then we'll take a break. And that is, through this channel years ago, we started talking about the four realms of pre-incarnation. And they are the angelic realm, the fairy realm, the earther or the material realm, and the techno realm. And what these realms signify are qualities of the universe that, by the way, yes, in fact, parallel the axis energy. But they are complete domains of universal experience that once a spark is cast from the Tao can actually go through. Now, why do we bring this up? For this reason. While you were all on the material plane, here on planet Earth, in physical form, in individual unique bodies, okay? Many of you have had previous incarnations, what you call grand cycles, that have been on these other planes or been in these other dimensions. And so you have memory of some of that. Well, the realm, the energy of the realm that will be, if you will, most closely flavoring the physical plane in this year is the fairy realm. The fairy realm is the has probably been most popularized and most made known to you by J.K. Rowling. She is the one that opened up this entire world. And just recently, of course, the movie about magical creatures and where to find them, those are all creatures of the fairy realm. Now, are we going to suggest you're going to be visited by leprechauns? No. Are we going to suggest that you're going to necessarily become a wizard or a witch? No. However, because the energy of this realm is so close, so to speak, so much aurically above and in your fields, you can request, you can ask, if you will, for the influence of this behind-the-scenes kind of energy to intercede, even be directive of, and enhance your experience. Divas, fairies, these kinds of non-physical energetic beings can enhance certain aspect of your own sensory acuity, for instance. They can act as little emissaries, especially when you don't use them in a negative way. In many cases, pixies, sprites, fairies, to have this idea where you have a sense of laughter or even mischief sometimes go through your mind, and you want to share it with somebody, you can beam that at someone, and they will pick it up, and there will be a way that it interjects into their energy field to shake someone up in a way that gives them an opportunity to be broken out of their sleepfulness. So, You can look it up. You can start investigating. What would it be like to issue an incantation? But be careful. People who play with the fairy realm also think about curses. Also think about damnations. And if you want to play in that energy, you will be sending yourself into the negative poles. Sometimes they can be very effective. In fact, you have very powerful people in this world right now who are doing them from the negative poles. And there will be backlash ramifications for that, for them. But we offer you that, and just know it's there and available to you. Your objective, put into four words, is to remember you're still alive, to stay awake, to enhance awareness, and wherever you can, engage enthusiasm. And if you can't engage enthusiasm directly, see if you can find some excitement for some engagement.
So it will be an interesting exploration for you of how you perceive, especially masculine energy, compassion. For those of you who, what we're about to say is to realize that you can have priest energy in masculine form and in feminine form. Feminine form priest energy would be like envelopment, ritual. It would be nurturing. It would be administering. Positive pole or masculine, expression priest energy would be what what they traditionally call tough love, or sometimes truth counsels. And where there is the judge on the bench. Leading for the pursuit of justice. And it can be very pointed and very intensive. So there are two, they are both the same energies that are expressed in different ways. Now there's one last thing we would like to say here too, is that as evidence of that, there's a couple of sub-personalities, qualities that inside of yourself that, that you as individuals and you also as kind of a collective will see up. We already talked to you about the fact that this priest energy and these overleaves are very insecure. They produce a lot of insecurity for people. In other words, a lack of emotional safety, but also a very great push in these for material security. Security being, literally your external sense of stability and defendedness against, the onslaughts of life's traumas or people, as the case may be. And people are not feeling that. People are feeling very insecure financially, they're emotionally. Culture is, very ramped up with a lot of now expressed hostility between groups and so forth. Well, the two sub-personalities that will be really playing within you to take a look at are, the first one is the guardian sub-personality. And the guardian is like everyone's priest embodied, but it is the priest that is the spiritual overlord of your own morality. The priest... A guardian subpersonality has that priest flavoring, and it has lots of guilt and accusation attached in it. In the positive pole, it can actually help you realize when you are, under, a great deal of criticism, and to say enough, but turned inward toward the self, it has the quality of, actually being your primary accuser. The guardian works with another sub called the judge. And the guardian is the one that suggests to the judge whether or not you be condemned. So, imagine that, statement off with her head or thumbs down in the arena. Comes from this, internal, this combination of these two qualities working together. the parts inside of yourself that are most important to actually consciously look at and develop are the part of yourself that we call the white knight and the father, particularly the part of the father known as the authority. The authority is the subpersonality that says where you know you're the decision maker. No matter whose information you're taking in, you still know it's your responsibility, it's your right, indeed your duty. But you're the one who holds the power. You need to go in there and with the white knight in all of you is your inner hero, your inner champion, and take a measure of what's your level of courage. Because this year, all of these overleaves together, we can tell you, we'll call upon you to face the high degree of fear that is out there in the world and that many of you are sampling in one degree or another, is to face it with courage. And courage is not the absence of fear. It is the decision to turn and face fear head on. The only thing you have to fear is fearing fear itself. Fear is a warning. Fear is a sign. But if you get afraid of being afraid, then it's got you. So with that in mind, we wish you all a very productive and worthwhile using your higher moving centers to find your flows, to establish those principles inside you, to align yourself with those people who you love and to those causes or those ideals that are important to you, to bring all those together to become a force in your own life. Take that power mode and use it. Good night.